Gobbler Gets Too Greedy in McCabe and Mrs. Miller, our last picture show at 11:40. But now on One, the 9 o'clock news is read by Eileen Dunn.
Building societies to tell central bank they won't agree to limit lending to home buyers. US, German and Italian forces come under fire in Albania as they help evacuate foreigners. Taoiseach warns he'll discipline Alan Shatter if he votes against the government on blood tribunal report. And Boyzone's Ronan Keating to present Eurovision with RTE's Carrie Crowley. Good evening. The building societies have said efforts by the central bank to dampen expectations in the property market will fail unless there is mortgage rationing. The societies also say they'll tell the bank that they won't agree voluntarily to limit lending to house buyers. The Irish Mortgage and Savings Association was reacting to yesterday's announcement by the bank that it would be contacting all mortgage lenders next week about their lending policies.
Financial institutions openly admit that they are awash with cash and are under pressure to lend out this money or they will become less profitable. However, the central bank has embarked on a campaign designed to put moral pressure on the mortgage institutions to become more careful about the amounts of money they are lending to people. The institutions do not believe that the central bank will succeed in its efforts to talk down property prices.
Unless they introduce rationing, it will not be effective, or unless they get agreement from the institutions to adopt a particular criteria which in effect will limit the number of loans that are available and the amount of finance that are available, then I don't think it'll work.
Is there any hope in your view that maybe you will get that kind of agreement?
Well, there will not be a voluntary agreement between institutions for obvious reasons, competitive reasons mainly, to limit the amount of finance available.
There is plenty of anecdotal evidence, however, that mortgage institutions have increased the amounts of money they are prepared to give borrowers.
I wouldn't agree. We're in the mortgage business now for the best part of a quarter of a century. We write about 12,000 mortgages a year, and we have very strict credit guidelines which we follow. And the process that happens in the bank is if you go in to apply for a mortgage to one of our branches, the application is prepared at the counter by a mortgage advisor and submitted centrally to our central lenders, who take an objective view and abide by proven credit guidelines.
Some economists believe the way to solve the property situation is for the authorities here to allow interest rates to go up so that mortgages become more expensive. The central bank seems to believe the way to solve the situation is to encourage lending institutions to lend less money. Builders believe the solution is for the politicians and local authorities to provide more serviced land sites for development. But all groups agree that we are in uncharted waters as far as the Irish property market is concerned.
In Albania, German, American and Italian forces came under fire today during the operation to airlift foreign nationals from the capital, Tirana. Meanwhile, a delegation from the Organisation for Security and Cooperation in Europe has met the Albanian Prime Minister and rebel representatives to discuss the escalating crisis.
It's the first time since World War II that German troops have opened fire outside their country. They were fired upon by the unknown occupants of these white vans as they oversaw the evacuation of EU nationals. No one was injured in the incident. US and Italian forces came under fire during similar operations as foreign nationals scrambled to leave the anarchy behind. The US temporarily suspended their operation. Earlier, Marines dug in to provide cover as Americans were airlifted to a waiting warship in the Adriatic. An Irish journalist and two Irish aid workers were also safely evacuated. The former Austrian Chancellor, Franz Warnitzky, heading a mission from the Organisation for Security and Cooperation in Europe, held talks with Bashkim Fino, the new Albanian Prime Minister. Both men agreed that Albania needs outside help.
So what the real important point is, to restore public order. The Albanian government says clearly, and I believe them, that they cannot do it on themselves and they need international help and support. And I think that's what we have to give a very, very urgent thought.
But it's hard to see what countries would volunteer to send troops to a country that is so out of control and so heavily armed. Rebels in the southern stronghold of Vlora also held a meeting to deliver an ultimatum to President Berisha: step down. Despite reports that he had fled the country, Mr. Berisha said today that he has no intention of resigning. Amazingly, he told journalists that he was an optimist and the situation was not beyond resolution. For the first time this evening, Albanian television showed pictures of the looting and chaos going on in Tirana. There is a menacing mood in the capital as tanks patrol the streets. The city's death toll has risen to 11, with 150 people injured as aimless shooting continues. A curfew is in force in Tirana tonight. A television report said police will fire without warning.
Back home, the Taoiseach has warned the Fine Gael backbencher Alan Shatter that he'll face disciplinary action if he carries out a threat to vote against the government in the Dáil debate on the Blood Tribunal report. In an interview today, Mr. Shatter said if the government didn't ensure that hepatitis C's victims received aggravated damages, he would have difficulty in supporting them in a vote on the issue. The victim support group Positive Action has welcomed Mr. Shatter's statement. They're to meet the Minister for Health on Wednesday, the day before the debate in the Dáil.
With the Dáil due to discuss the Blood Tribunal report next week, the issue of whether the hepatitis C victim should be entitled to aggravated damages will be high on the political agenda. The Compensation Tribunal under Mr. Justice Egan can only make awards on a no-fault basis. In effect, it can't raise the amount to punish those who were at fault. But given Mr. Justice Finlay's findings that the Blood Board and some of its staff had been negligent, there have been demands that the Compensation Tribunal's terms of reference should be amended to allow for the award of aggravated damages. Positive Action has strongly articulated that position. Today, the victims' group got the backing of Fine Gael backbencher Alan Shatter.
If the government turns its back on the award of aggravated damages, and if any individual member of the Dáil tables a motion in relation to that issue, I would find it extremely difficult to vote against the payment of aggravated damages to the women concerned.
Government and Fine Gael sources reacted with extreme annoyance to Mr. Shatter's interview, describing it as a cheap shot and calculated opportunism, given that the Cabinet is due to consider the Blood report in detail next week. In a letter, the Taoiseach reminded his backbencher that he'd pledged to sit and vote with Fine Gael in the Dáil. In effect, a vote against the government would mean disciplinary action. Mr. Bruton also said the government was giving special consideration to the position of the hepatitis C victims. Ministers will discuss the question of aggravated damages next week in the context of a report from the Attorney General, and they'll attempt to assess the costs involved. However, Alan Shatter says the awards need not be large.
They're symbolic recognition that someone has behaved very badly in the exercise of their public duties. And I don't believe that it will be a huge additional financial burden.
For their part, Fianna Fáil, who've backed aggravated damages, will bring the matter to a head in the Dáil debate on Thursday.
The High Court in London has once again refused a bail application by Roisin McCallisky. Afterwards, her solicitor Gareth Pearce said her client's improved prison conditions wouldn't last. The authorities in Germany are seeking Ms. McCallisky's extradition in connection with an IRA attack. One British minister has strongly criticised the campaign for Ms. McCallisky in a letter in which he used the term IRA scum.
This afternoon, supporters of Roisin McCallisky gathered outside the High Court in London. Inside, at a private hearing, her lawyers attempted to persuade a judge that she should be released on bail pending a full hearing of the German extradition request. After 2 hours, though, the judge had rejected the application.
Of course, we would prefer that she were not in custody. Her conditions were slightly improved, but on the basis of past experience from the prison service, that will not last a minute. Undertakings are repeatedly broken, assurances are given that are not fulfilled, and that's precisely what we fear will happen here.
She's expecting a baby in May. She's been in custody since last November, and her health is giving serious cause for concern. But the British government's hard-line approach to her case was demonstrated by remarks from Home Office Minister David McLean, who in a letter to a constituent about the case referred to the evil scum of the IRA.
Well, I saw the reports this morning and I think the reports were grotesque. They were quite grotesque when you saw what actually David McLean had written and the way two separate things were run together. So I suggest people look at what really happened.
And when you look at Mr. McLean's statement today and the support of the Home Office and the British Prime Minister for it, it's quite clear that no High Court judge will be allowed to give Róisín McCallisky bail. And the British government has joined battle for some perverse, racist reason of its own.
The judge who rejected bail today has told Róisín McCallisky's lawyers that they can return with another bail application if her circumstances change.
The DUP has said Sinn Féin should be a proscribed organisation following last night's bomb attack on a security patrol in Belfast. The party's deputy leader, Peter Robinson, also called for a media ban on Sinn Féin.
Peter Robinson's comments came in the wake of last night's attack on a joint British Army RUC foot patrol in the Nationalist Short Strand area of East Belfast. A soldier and a police officer sustained serious shrapnel wounds when a device exploded near an alleyway by Strand Close. Four other security personnel were treated for shock.
There had been children playing in the area just immediately before the device went off. And I'm very, very unhappy that these people can carry out such criminal acts at 10 past 10 in the evening.
It was the second attack in Belfast within 12 hours. Earlier, a soldier was injured in the Nationalist Ardoyne area when an improvised grenade-type device was fired at a patrol.
We had Gerry Adams sickeningly telling us how he was attempting to further a peace process. The government have to proscribe Sinn Féin, show that they are outside the democratic process, that they don't use democratic means. And I believe that we should have an effective ban on the media availability for Sinn Féin.
Yesterday there was an attack in Ardoyne, last evening an attack in East Belfast. One can see the machinery being cranked up. I have no doubt that as loyalism begins to parade the world stage and what is a symbolic time, St. Patrick's Day, with an agenda of their own and with an agenda that is solidly wedded towards peace and democracy, I think the Provos are in serious, serious trouble.
The L.E. Kira has been investigating an alleged ramming incident off the south coast involving a Spanish trawler. A British-registered fishing vessel reported that it had been hit by a Spanish boat at lunchtime, about 50 miles south of Mizzen Head. Meanwhile, in Bantry, five members of the Spanish-owned fishing vessel, which was involved in Sunday's fatal collision off the south coast, are still being detained for questioning by Gardaí. The Israeli government has vowed to go ahead with a new Jewish settlement in Arab East Jerusalem next week, despite world pleas not to. The Israeli cabinet has also appointed a committee of inquiry to look into the shooting dead yesterday of seven Israeli schoolgirls by a Jordanian soldier. Anti-Jordanian demonstrations have continued in Tel Aviv. However, Jordan says there's no suggestion of a political motive for the killings. Five of the girls have been buried following funeral services attended by Prime Minister Netanyahu. And there we take a break, but still to come on the 9 o'clock news, no Cayley dancing for President Clinton on St. Patrick's Day. Doctors say he'll be on crutches for weeks. And Fiche Cúig Bliain Fós, President Robinson in Connemara to celebrate 25 years of Radio na Gaeltachta. Welcome to part two. The main news this evening, building societies have said efforts by the central bank to dampen expectations in the property market will fail unless there's mortgage rationing. Next week's summit between President Bill Clinton and President Boris Yeltsin is to go ahead despite an injury President Clinton suffered in a fall last night. Mr. Clinton is undergoing surgery for a torn tendon at the Bethesda Naval Hospital near Washington. But there are doubts over whether President Clinton will be able to fulfil his St. Patrick's Day engagements in Washington.
President Clinton was taking a break in Florida, where he played a round with Australian golf star Greg Norman. Before the game, the president was worried about his performance.
I've got to at least break my handicap.
But it's another kind of handicap he's worried about now. After what was described as a late-night chat with Greg Norman, the president suffered an accident.
At about 1:20 this morning, the president was visiting Greg Norman at his residence. He slipped as he was coming down a set of stairs at the Norman residence and twisted his knee.
And there was worse.
It looks like he won't be able to play golf as well.
This morning, the president was putting a brave face on it, but was obviously in pain.
Apparently an old skiing injury had come back to haunt him on the eve of St. Patrick's weekend. He's due in surgery tonight, so will he make his meeting with the Taoiseach on Monday?
If all goes well, anticipate being discharged this weekend.
His arrival back in Washington was less dignified than usual. He was taken to Bethesda Naval Hospital, where he told doctors he was determined to make his summit date with Boris Yeltsin on Wednesday.
The president was very firm that he was going to Helsinki, and while we probably say, you know, wouldn't necessarily always recommend that, certainly it can be done very safely.
The meeting is being held in Helsinki, so President Yeltsin doesn't have to travel too far.
Gardaí investigating a raid on a licensed arms dealers in Donegal say they're very concerned about what use the stolen guns will be put to. At least four armed men were involved in the raid at Milford, in which a large number of guns and ammunition were taken.
John Diver was locking up the business premises at his home at 8:45 last night when a man carrying a sawn-off shotgun and wearing a balaclava took the keys from him. A second armed man pushed him to the floor, and when his wife Agnes appeared, she too was made to lie on the floor of the armoury. The gang of at least four men then loaded guns into the family car, which they used for their getaway.
The raiders were selective. Out of a large quantity of arms, they took a total of 16 middle-of-the-range sporting shotguns and an assorted quantity of ammunition. They left behind several heavy arms and high-calibre ammunition.
The Diver's car, a slate-coloured Primera 92D20066, was abandoned at Cullion Road, Letterkenny, and Gardaí are appealing for information on any suspicious activity in that area and between Letterkenny and Milford. At this stage, they say they're ruling nothing in or out in the investigation.
There's nothing to suggest at the scene that there was a paramilitary organisation involved, or where the car was abandoned at Letterkenny, there was nothing to suggest that it was a precise paramilitary organisation.
But given what they took, guns, it must be of concern to you.
Well, of course it's concern to me. The robbery itself causes me concern, and also the fact that now 16 guns are in the hands of criminals, and they could be used for other nefarious activities like armed robberies, where they could be sawn off and used in other armed robberies.
The Heinz Corporation is promising to create an extra 200 jobs in Dundalk by doubling the size of its food factory in the town. The factory, which produces pizzas, will now become the manufacturing centre for the Heinz Weight Watcher frozen food range for Europe. The £20 million expansion announced by Heinz Chief Executive Tony O'Reilly comes as the corporation is closing 25 factories elsewhere as part of a global restructuring of its operations. Industrial action, which threatened to disrupt the Leaving Cert Applied exam, has been called off. The Public Service Executive Union was in dispute with the Department of Education over staffing. The TUI has welcomed the decision and has called on the department to make arrangements for the exams without delay. Detectives have released without charge a 28-year-old County Louth man who was arrested on Monday following the seizure of almost £4 million worth of drugs in Rosslare. The consignment of cannabis resin was discovered during a search of a lorry by the Customs National Drugs Team. It's understood that a file is being prepared for the DPP. A European Parliament report has warned that the European Union is facing a smuggling crisis. The report says billions of pounds have been lost since controls were eased in 1993, especially in the trade in illegal cigarettes.
The trade in illegal cigarettes on Dublin's Henry Street. A practical example of what the report says is the widespread breakdown of the customs system. Cigarette smuggling has proved attractive to criminals because of the huge difference between the duty-free and the duty-paid price, and because the sums of money to be made are massive. 611 billion cigarettes are smoked in the EU every year. In Ireland, the receipts from excise and VAT are worth £530 million. That's 5.4% of total government revenue. But the report says that 4% of cigarettes now bought in Ireland are contraband. And one Dublin MEP says the figure in the capital is higher still.
From my own inquiries with people involved in customs and in revenue and so on, I am reliably informed, and from the retail trade itself, they're able to compute this and they tell me that 10% is the figure for Dublin.
The report argues that cigarette and alcohol smuggling should not be treated as minor victimless offences because it says the evidence is that they're linked to large-scale organised crime and to terrorism.
A lot of the evidence we've received has been confidential, and we have a great amount of detail which links all manner of crime together.
The report recommends far greater cooperation between customs services and the total overhaul of the checking procedures. Otherwise, it says the chances are that more and more smuggled goods will make their way onto the streets.
President Robinson has praised Radio na Gaeltachta for what she called its outstanding contribution to Irish life. The president said the station had given a great impetus to Irish, which wasn't just a symbol of our identity, but also a bond between people worldwide.
Radio na Gaeltachta was formally launched by President de Valera on Easter Sunday 1972. This morning, President Robinson arrived at Airnéidí headquarters at Castle in Connemara to take part in ceremonies marking 25 years of broadcasting. The chairman of the RTÉ Authority, Farrell Corcoran, the minister, Michael D. Higgins, the camera of Radio na Gaeltachta, and top RTÉ personnel were among the hundreds invited to greet her. Having toured the studios, she unveiled a plaque to mark the occasion.
Nor hothic on spotum shaw e crela, sublian nijeg shakta do, ni doka gerhid moron dini, on maid dull hun kin a yensi.
Many well-known faces in broadcasting and politics joined in the president's tribute to Radio na Gaeltachta, some more well-known than others.
25 years ago, people believed that this station wouldn't last. There was talks after 6 months, how we get the musicians, how we get the talkers, how we get people, but it went on and on.
It started small at Easter 1972 and has grown to be a national service which is on air from 8 o'clock in the morning to 12 hours later in the evening, and that they now plan to increase that again, and I hope that in 25 years' time there will be a similar occasion for a comprehensive Irish language television service.
We started off 25 years ago with 7 broadcasters with no experience whatsoever, broadcasting locally 2 hours per day. 25 years later, we have 100 of a staff, 12 hours per day, 7 days a week, national, and as well as that, we can be heard in Europe and America.
Finally, Boyzone's lead singer Ronan Keating and the RTÉ presenter Carrie Crowley are to present the Eurovision Song Contest from the Point Theatre in Dublin. And millions of viewers around Europe will be able to vote over the phone for their favourite song and have a direct say in the outcome of the contest.
In 1995, Mary Kennedy stood before the cameras and, electronically, behind them, upwards of 300 million viewers. This time, the focus is already on the heartthrob of Irish teenagers and his co-presenter, Carrie Crowley.
For me personally, it's really special because RTÉ have always used in-house people to present the show, and I'm the first person ever outside of RTÉ to present it. Whereas Carrie now, she's in RTÉ, which is great.
Have you had time yet to think about your possible worst nightmare on the night?
I think the worst thing that could happen is that none of the juries come through, or that one of us would fall and land kind of, you know, head over heels on the stage.
On our platform.
Which would be dreadful, but it's not going to happen.
What advice would Mary Kennedy offer them?
Enjoy the preparations and take time to reflect. And this is a once-in-a-lifetime experience, a one-off, and on the 3rd of May, it really is the culmination of all of this, and it's important to take every step as it comes, to do the homework, to be fit, eat well, as my mother would say, because you'll need your stamina, and then enjoy it all.
But elsewhere in RTÉ today, there were bitterly disappointed people and one bird.
Dustin, as you can see, he's a broken turkey, and he did numerous French lessons.
I spent about 3 weeks learning that language, and it's fardin.
It is. Well, Dusty, let's hear some of your French then.
Like, this will just give you an example of how good actually he'd become at the French language.
Bonjour, Ferdinand. Hill de Ferme. Welcome to the 25th year of vision.
See?
Well, there's always next year. The main news again this evening. Building societies say efforts by the central bank to dampen expectations in the property market will fail unless there is mortgage rationing. The societies also say they won't agree voluntarily to limit lending to house buyers. And that's the main news this Friday. Late Extra will follow the Late Late Show. But from me until Monday at 9, good evening.